hartelijk welkom hier. We zijn er weer. Ik ga eerst even iets in Engels zeggen en dan kom ik weer bij jullie terug. Hello everybody. Welcome to all our Facebook and YouTube viewers. Especially the ones in Argentina, Peru, Chile. If you like it, you can hit the like button. If you want to ask a question, Tom has promised me he will answer all the questions under the YouTube film we're making today. So under the live stream, just any comment is a good comment. And if you have a question, he will answer them personally. Now I'm going to say something in Dutch and then I'll get back to all of you live on YouTube en Facebook. Goedenavond allemaal. Welkom hier in Huizen. We zijn live op Facebook en op YouTube. Vandaar dat we straks de hele presentatie in het Engels gaan doen. Maar ik wou jullie allemaal eerst even heel hartelijk welkom heten in het Nederlands. Want dat vind ik dan wel zo netjes. En natuurlijk, als we helemaal klaar zijn met de presentatie, dan is de voertaal ook weer gewoon Nederlands, Brabants, Twents. Maakt me niet uit, maar dan praten we gewoon weer in onze eigen taal. Goed, hello and welcome everybody, especially, as I said, our YouTube and Facebook viewers. Well, I think we can all agree that we can trust Tim and Tom to do something on social media when they present their 2019 Dakar team, their Dakar car, and it had to be on social media. It's that time of year again. Here in Holland, days are getting shorter, nights are getting colder. Days are still quite nice, but trust me, they will get wetter and colder too very soon. And on the other side of the world, in Peru, days are getting longer. It's springtime, it's getting hotter, and that's time you sort of get the butterflies in your stomach. It's Dakar time. Our RTL pre-prologue in Valkenswaard in Holland. Sorry, you can't be there if you're outside the country, but it's still going to happen this Sunday. So that's usually, for me, the start of, Dakar is just around the corner. It is going to happen. I have to work all day. All the Dakar people, it's like one big family. And of course, Tim and Tom are a very big part of that family. So in Peru, spring is in the air, and trust us, we will be there early January. It might be funny, but Peru is the only country we will visit this year. But it also has a lot of similarities with, where Dakar originated, in Africa. Lots of sand dunes, lots of technical challenges, and lots of camaraderie. And I'm sure camaraderie, technical challenges, and a lot of sand will happen in Peru. It will be the 11th time we're in South America. Hi, kids. Enjoying yourself. It will be the 11th time we're in South America. And it will be probably one of the toughest rallies there is. Now, it is a tough rally, the Dakar Rally. It is probably the world's toughest rally. And the easy way to do it, if there is any easy way, is you rent a truck and you get a good mechanic and you go and do the Dakar Rally. Well, and that is a challenge. I'm not saying that's easy. That is a challenge. And you can be really, really, really satisfied once you've made it onto the finish podium. But there is a way to make it even tougher for yourself. That is, you start your own team. You get a Jefferies Buggy. You think, let's make it a three-year project. And then it gets harder and harder. And after 2018, that Jefferies Buggy, which we maybe after this year call the Coronel Buggy, I don't know, we'll talk about it in a minute, will hopefully have a trouble-free rally. Well, you never have a trouble-free rally. And the two guys that know that more than anybody else, probably in the world, Tim and Tom Coronel. Okay, so we all know them. If you're watching on Facebook or YouTube, that's Tom, yep. And that's Tim.
Are you sure?
Easy to recognize them. Tim's the one with the glasses, and Tom's the one who hasn't shaved.
Who's gray.
He didn't shave this morning.
No.
He's already in Dakar mode.
It's not only this morning, but it's very easy. Tim has a dot on the eye here, so that's how you can recognize him.
A dot on the eye. Well, you have to dot all the I's to get to the end of the rally this year, Tom. So, but that's a different I. Can I just go back? It's going to be the third time you two will share a car in the rally. And I made a little note which says, from bowler, but that wasn't really a bowler, was it? It was from bowler to what? What are we going to call this car? The beast.
Yeah, we know it's a beast. I mean, it's different. It's bigger.
Yeah.
It's more loud. It's more powerful. It's stronger. It's more difficult to handle. and of course, you know, it's more fun because this type of car, you know, has a lot of fans because Robbie Gordon already started to drive with these type of machines. You know, when this car enters a village, the fans go completely lunatic because it's different than all the other cars. And this was also the reason when last year Tim said, Tom, we're going to do Dakar together. We were checking out some different type of brands and chassis. And finally, Tim said, what do you think of this? And we just start laughing. I said, and Tim said, I don't think we have to think further or find a different car. I said, no. And yeah, this was the case. This is how it started.
Yeah, it's sort of, Tim, is that part of your own Dakar challenge? You don't go to a proven team with a proven car. You just want to do everything yourself. That is part of your Dakar spirit.
A little bit. I always say Dakar is a way of life, and life in that way for me is good. And I love to engineer, to be together with other people, other engineers, our mechanics, and we enjoy the whole year.
Well, you don't enjoy every minute in that car. I know that for a fact.
To be honest, that's Dakar. Dakar is Dakar, and it needs to be tough. But always when you're there at the finish, you are like world champion of everything.
Well, I mean, I must admit, you and both of you, whenever you finished the rally, I mean, you did the buggies for a couple of years, and finally you made it together, and both of you are hardly ever see a teardrop in your eye. But when you finish the Dakar rally, both of you, it's guaranteed. Good television. They start crying.
Yeah, but this is not because of this. It's just emotionally.
Yeah.
They're trying to break your mind during this period of time. And you know, this is what is it? Something like 15 days strong fight. Only a few hours of sleep. Not so good food because you have no time. It's a consistent roller coaster of up and down, and then. Yeah, at one stage, I mean, you have only one thing in your mind. I have to go from A to B, and for the rest, whatever happens in between, it doesn't matter. And then it's a fight between the machine, between ourselves, between the nature, between the big June. I mean, when we're there, do we have to go up there? Yep. Okay, let's try. You know, and these kind of things, you know, this is strange that it's possible. And this is consistently, yeah, an emotional ride. And then once you're at the finish, yeah, you just break. You can't help it. You just break.
Yeah.
How big you are, how strong you are.
Another thing that you two did break last year, and I didn't really expect it, but you did break the car a couple of times, which was a little bit unexpected, Tim.
you could say break the car, or it got a little bit naked.
Yeah.
That's what you meant, I guess. First we lost the hood, I guess, a few times. Then the back. Then I flipped it once on the side. And, last day
can
at the
you
finish.
Can you say that one more time? Yeah.
I flipped it. And at the last day, before the finish, this is funny, I never told anybody, Tom said, Tim, you forgot one thing. You forgot the top. Yeah. So that was the last few meters. But on the other hand, the car is strong. Jefferies did really a good job and in that way. And yeah, it's a funny car to drive. It's you have a smile from ear to ear all the time.
I just realized when you flipped it, the car, it was in some sort of ditch and people couldn't pass. And some of the competitors actually came to see me and said, that Tim and Tom bastard, or yeah, bastardo, yeah. Yeah, as
yeah.
They're called.
Yeah, yeah.
They do everything to be on television. They even block us all.
Well, it was just it through a valley.
Yeah, yeah.
And Tim, at once, he just went up and right. He said, what are you doing? Yeah, you're right. And hop, he flipped left. And we went straight down, straight up on the other side. And then the car just floop. flipped, and nobody could pass us, something like 40 competitors behind us. So, yeah, everybody got out of the car, and yeah, we got finally...
even the Russians helped us.
I know.
Yeah, but they had no choice. So, these things happen. It was quite funny because we were hanging in there. Tim was looking at me. He said, sorry. I said, Tim, I don't care. Come on, let's get out and fix it. Because, you know, that's the mode you have to be in.
Let's get out and fix it. It was more than once last year that happened. 2018 was a very eventful Dakar Rally for the brothers. We put them together in like 8 minutes, 9 minutes. Start the video, boys.
Blijf kijken, wordt een vet avontuur.
Doei doei!
De Coronel Brothers gaan net als in 2009 samen het avontuur aan. In de nieuwe Jefferies Buggy die ze helemaal naar eigen inzicht hebben aangepast. Het is een beest van een auto, maar wel met de nodige kinderziektes.
We hebben alleen maar problemen. De auto sloeg iedere keer vast. Op een gegeven moment één keer watertemperatuur. 130 graden. We vertrouwen het niet. Het voelt allemaal niet goed. Wat een start, jongen. Wat een drama is dit. Het is echt niet normaal. De motor wordt gewoon heet.
Dat was lekker, Tim.
Ja, ik wil niet.
Mama mia.
We hebben weinig gezicht.
Ja.
Dat was hem niet.
Nee.
Oh, maar we zijn er wel.
Dat bedoel ik.
Oh, heb ik hoor.
Tim is zichtbaar aangedaan door de vroegtijdige problemen met de buggy. Maar het doel is de finish halen en opgeven staat niet in het woordenboek van Tim en Tom. Altijd doorgaan is het devies, maar dat wordt lastig als de grote duinen opduiken. Maar het plezier is van korte duur, want de problemen met de buggy blijven zich opstapelen. Gelukkig zijn de mannen niet voor één gat te vangen en weten ze altijd wel weer een oplossing te bedenken.
Nou, we staan met pannen. We zagen net, begon wat te roken, dus we zien dat die olie lekt, de motor. We gaan even de olie even peilen. Nou, het is wel gaaf hier, even kijken. Kijken zeg.
Ik moet schoenen hebben.
Oké. We zien hier dat hij een klein beetje olie gelekt heeft. Daar kan je het zien. Daar bovenin. Nou, dat is natuurlijk niet goed. Moeten we even maken.
Ik denk ook dat het goed wordt. Hè? Ja. Ja. Ik wil geen olie op die uitlaat.
Oké. Tim is nu met wat locals. Benzine aan het overladen. Hallo. Thank you for helping. Thank you. Hoeveel liter wil je?
Nou ja, als het maar mengt.
We willen iets van 10 liter pakken en dan komt het wel goed. En hier staan we met... is dit Zuurmond, is dat toch? Ja. Hier zijn hele grote dikke Jordaanen.
Dat
willen we niet in.
60. Nee. Dit is het dus. Of 5 keer 60 is 6 keer 60. Maar even voor de voorbeeld. Hè.
Dus dan ga je 2 kilometer in. 1, 2. Correct?
Ja. Mooi. Okay.
En dan kap.
Zijn met z'n allen.
Ik zie er nog een kap. Kap 54. Hoeveel kilometer?
Richard. En Surmond. Nee,
1,25.
Zonder voorraad.
Ik heb een keer met jou op het berg willen slapen.
Wat zeg je?
Ik heb altijd een keer met jou op het berg willen slapen.
Ja? Gaan we lepeltje liggen dan?
Prima, ik ben er klaar mee.
Nou jongens, ik zeg wel te rusten.
Slaapzak te pakken.
Hebben jullie slaapzakken bij je?
Mm-hmm.
Oh, dat is mooi.
Ja, ben,
wij niet. Wij niet. Ik ga je zo een heel lijstje geven, oké? Okay? Ik weet niet wat ik moet zeggen. Wel te rusten. Wat een kutzooi. Iets in de richting.
Dat zei je?
Nee, ik heb nooit gezegd dat je eruit moest.
Oh.
Nooit. Ik zeg dat je in de canyon moet blijven.
Guys.
dit dan, jongens? Geloof het er niet. Kom je Bolivia's, ze springen op je auto. Ze gaan er allemaal op zitten. En kijk dan die spandoeken. Wow. Geef me de pedal. Thank you. Thank you. Dit is niet normaal, hè?
Dit is lachen, hè?
Dit is lachen. Oh, cool.
Dank je.
Te gek. Niet normaal, Tim.
Heerlijk.
Allemaal Frans.
Yep.
Nou, de enige kant die is nog goed, dat is zijn eigen kant. Ja, dat zou ik ook doen als ik hem was. Een rijder. Hij heeft er een mooie bende van gemaakt, dat kan ik je even vertellen.
De twee gele helmen verraden nog net wie het zijn, maar de buggy is na alle avonturen onherkenbaar. Toch weten Tim en Tom wederom de finish te bereiken. Een wereldprestatie na alle problemen.
Staan we dan bij de finish 2018.
Is klaar.
Ja, is klaar, gedaan. Was wat harder dan we hadden gedacht.
Maar we zijn heel blij.
Ja, we zijn wel blij. De beast heeft ons een beetje in de steek gelaten hier en daar. Maar ja, we weten in ieder geval de punten waar we moeten verbeteren.
Dat is vooral cool.
Zijn er best wel een paar.
Ja.
Koeling en een beetje bodywork. Een beetje spare material meenemen. Want hij rijdt iedere keer alles eraf.
Hij wordt een beetje naked, hè? Hey jongens.
Jongens, op naar 2019.
Doei, doei.
Ja. Yeah. That was... Sorry to all the people that don't speak Dutch. That half of that was in Dutch, but... Anyway, we'll make it up to you. And listen, there's one thing before we... Because now we talk about the new car, but before that, can either of you tell me what it's like to drive through Bolivia into a little village and have local people have a banner? Tim and Tom. Tim Alpha, Tom Romeo Corona. I mean,
we know
how
why.
Crazy is that?
It's because we are extrovert. We show our emotion. We're there for the adventure.
But Tommy, this is Bolivia somewhere.
Yeah, but you know, it's social media.
I mean, this is not a mess around the corner.
Okay,
here.
But it's not only Bolivia. It's in Argentina. It was in Peru. It's very easy because the car is different. We are different. We're twins. I mean, there are too many unique things.
And we have an appointment. Everywhere where our banner is, we always stop.
One time we didn't stop. I remember we were in a hurry, and it was quite a good story. It was on a big road, and we said, come on, we only have 15 minutes to hit our time slot. So at that stage, we said, okay. And we were on a road, and we were driving, I think, 150 km, and we're, whoo! And he said, Tim, you saw the same? Yeah, we saw the same. But while we were speaking about it, we were already 4 km further. So to go back and forth takes 10 minutes.
Yeah.
So we didn't stop. And then 2 days later, we saw the same...
At the finish.
It was a mother and a daughter. We saw them standing at finish. We were so sorry we didn't stop. But so we had to talk to them.
Anyway, I know you stop when there is a banner, but I must admit you stop also when there's no banners, but that's a different story. If you like the video, if you like the live stream, please press like somewhere.
Yep.
And if you have a question, Tom has promised me he will answer all the questions.
Have fun.
Have fun.
Yep. All right, so that was 2018. Yep. The car ended up looking more like the buggy we used to have than the buggy you took to South America this year. So you come back and you make a little list what you want to change on the car.
The little list was a little bit long list.
Okay.
It was 4 pages at the front and the back.
Yeah, so 8 pages really?
So 8 pages, and of course we wanted to do it in a good way. And we just looked at the timesheet and eventually, we ended up to do it here ourselves, because otherwise to send it to the US and to get it back was too much of a time loss. So eventually, we just started.
When? When do you start with that?
We started already when the car came back. The beast, the naked beast, first had to go to some shows.
And, for the sponsors?
For the sponsors, of course.
But then it was not naked again, because there were no stickers on the naked beast.
There was nothing on the car. It was just dirty and dust. And then finally, when we made the whole list, also during the whole rally, we said, okay, we need to change this to make the car Coronel Dakar proof, you know, because... It also has a Coronel certificate, I think, needed. And then finally, yeah, we just start building. When Tim said, okay, we need it here for the spare time, we start to build our own workshop, which is near here in Huizen. Quite big workshop.
Yes, because you have to explain, before that, when you had the little buggies, and even this buggy, I think, it was all built at your house.
Well, it was built at my house with with Tim in the lead for the technical part. As you saw in the videos, you saw Tim was working on the car and I was making the videos. This is because Tim is technical, very handy, and working all year on the car.
The thing I really do appreciate with Tom is that every time in the video he says, we have to change the wheel. We have to repair the car. And that means I hold the camera and Tim repairs
the car.
There's
something special when you are twins.
Yes, yes. Yeah, very like special. Yeah. I would have hit him. But anyway, so you make a list. You think like, okay, what do we do? What was priority number one? Was it like something like weight saving or get the engine run cooler? Or where do you start?
There were two.
And what do you do?
The biggest problem, we couldn't get the speed in because the car got too hot all the time, the water temperatures and the oil temperatures. So eventually, the cooling was, of course, the biggest issue because you want to drive as quick as possible.
You
want to
go flat out.
Yeah, but you had to lift the throttle all the time. So that was hard. And then you also know with racing, when you're light, yeah, you want to have less weight. So that was also a big thing. And of course the airflow, and of course it was easy because we could start from scratch because there was nobody anymore. So eventually I met a guy from Lit in Nijmegen, Van Tul, and he told me, how do you like this backlight? So I was looking at the backlight. I said, okay, let's start here. So we started at the backlights of a Nissan Qashqai.
Actually, the first model looked like a Nissan Qashqai.
Oh, thanks. No, that's how we started. And then eventually, when you start the adventure, you don't live yourself, you are being lived. And then there are a lot of partners here in the room who help you and support you. And then Tom is coming in, of course, every time. For the first time this year, we have never seen him so much in the workshop. So thank you for your support also.
So the film needed to be made.
So it's fun. No, it is fun. And of course, it takes a lot of time and energy, but proud.
It's for us, the Dakar is not only the race itself. You know, it's the whole way to the rally itself. It's for us the period when we start to talk with sponsors, when we start to talk between each other, and when teams say, okay, are we going to do it? Yes, of course. You know, and then, okay, but how? We see later. Let's just start, you know. It's not a business case. It's just starting,
sure,
you know, it's with a lot of risk, but anyway, which is part of the Dakar also. And for Tim, it's a way of living because for Tim, it's you know, he's nearly every day working on the car and thinking about the car. Of course, we discussed a lot of things we needed to change on the car. And I think now finally, you know, it's called the Beast Part 2. Because we committed ourselves for 3 years, which will be 20 years, which is not a problem. But for the story, of course, it should be at least 3 years. Because first year is to see what the car is. Second year is to put it a Coronel certificate on the Jefferies Buggy. And then the third year to be in competition with the top guys.
Yeah. And then I've been in the workshop a couple of times this year. And it's, how big is your team? I mean, because we know when you go to the rally, I think there's about 8 or 9 guys. That's the whole Coronel team. But there's a lot of people helping you, working weekends, working nights. I think it's the only part of the industrial estate where the lights are on at midnight.
Yeah, a lot of times the police come by. So yeah.
So how many people and how many people are actually helping?
Eventually, I think we are with 18 people. One and different in time-wise. There are like 6 people full-time. And then, of course, partners, and the other 12 are coming in and out, and we try to do our best. And, of course, the more enthusiastic you are, the more they help and also are enthusiastic. And the last 2 weeks, we have two guys from 14 or 16, I don't know even, but they help us by cleaning, so that helped us. We don't have to clean anymore, and we can do other things. So now we are with 20 people, to be honest, yeah.
The problem is they're also addicted now. You know, it's a virus. That's
good.
What it is.
But that's a good virus. That's the one and only good virus to have. So You have a lot of volunteers. You have a lot of people that help every night of the week, every weekday, every weekend. They're working to get this beast ready for Dakar. And of course, there's always the Tom Cam. And they've documented every minute of the build of Beast Part 2.
Ja jongens, we gaan beginnen. Kijk, daar staat hij. Helemaal naakt. Niets erop. Dat moet hem worden. Fred, we gaan beginnen met de bouwen.
Helemaal opnieuw gepoederkoot. Netjes gemaakt. Nou, ze zijn de vloer er al aan het inmeten. Hier komt de tank dan in te zitten. Nou, daar komt natuurlijk de motor en de versnellingsbak. Zijn we aan het doen?
We gaan een nieuw dashboard maken. Iets steviger. En dat alle meters op een mooie plekje kunnen zitten. Dus een klein beetje spaghetti. Lijkt toch, maar het wordt heel netjes straks.
Het begint lekker op te schieten. Weer een dagje verder. Vanavond komt de versnellingsbak en de motor. Die hebben op de testbank gestaan. Het ziet er allemaal erg goed uit. En je ziet... Ja...
Iedere keer weer een stapje verder. Ja, kilootje of 90.
Ja jongens, de volgende stap gaat gebeuren. En dat is die jongen erin. Dat is de LS3 motor. Komt net van de tuner vandaan. Ik kan de cijfers natuurlijk niet vertellen, dat is allemaal geheim. Maar dat is de volgende stap. En kijk, hier zie je de bak zit er al netjes in. Daarna gaat de tank erin. Ja, en dan nog een paar kistjes die even uitgesorteerd dienen te worden.
It's ready. It started. It's ready. And a year ago, we were in Utrecht. We had the Beast.
Yep.
You started the Beast. And I think the first time you actually drove the Beast, other than in America, was at our RTL GP pre-prologue in Valkenswaard. That's the very first time you drove the car.
The first lap, even Damon Jefferies drove it. So,
but it's important to go testing because now you have a product, and the product is, well, it's almost a finished product, but it's never finished.
Racing cars never finished.
Exactly. So you need to go testing.
Yep, that's what we did.
We don't have dunes here in Holland. Well, we do in Zandvoort by the sea, but they're not big enough, and you probably get a lot of trouble with the police if you go and test there.
Now, eventually, we have a good friend from Kingshocks in Spain, Xavier Herrador. He builds also his own Dakar cars. And he said, Tim, please come over. Then we do the shocks and we can make the car better. So we have a nice field here in Spain, 2,500 kilometers from Valencia. And
it's not that far.
It's not that far. But eventually, we went there last weekend.
Yeah, to have a really nice test in the dry, because it never rains around there.
No, it's never wet there.
No. Except last week.
Except last week.
It was very good for fishing.
Yeah. There was a lot of fishes in the streets and everything. So again, we had a challenge. But on the other hand, that's Dakar. And then that's always funny, because Tom was outside on the phone all the time. And eventually Tom came in and said, I have a solution.
No. Well, I have a solution. You said to what is it, Xavier?
Tom came in the workshop. Oh, good. Car's good. I said we only have one problem. We don't go testing.
And I went to Spain. So I said, but what do you mean we don't go testing? Well, there are some thunderstorms planned tomorrow here in Valencia, and as today the water was running through the streets. So we can't go testing because we're in the mud.
Have you ever been to Bolivia?
Yeah, well,
that's the same.
Finally, I said, no way, we're going testing. So I called my friend Manel, which was my engineer at Sunred Racing at WTCC with the Seat, and because he was living in Spain and he was working with rally cars, World Rally Car Championship with the Skoda. So I said, hey, my friend, we need a test track
tomorrow.
Sorry? I said, yeah, tomorrow. He said, well, I have a good friend, Xavi Pons. He is a well-known rally driver, did world championships, also did a few times Dakar. Yep. And he had in his backyard, well, in Spain probably it's normal with those type of guys, a few mountains with a whole area and woods. So it was on our way back. So we woke up 4 o'clock in the morning. 5 o'clock we were in the car and we drove to Barcelona. And it was 100 kilometers to north of Barcelona. And we said, okay. This looks like a reasonable test track. Let's play.
You actually said, why did we go to Valencia in the first place?
First of all, we had to go to our friend from King Shops because we changed the setup of the car. We went to the double shock system on the front. And of course, he's the expert with the shocks. Yeah. So we had to make a reasonable good setup because the car has also been changed. And finally, we did that at the test track of Xavi.
So the big question now is, are you happy with that first test, Tim?
Let's look at it. No, I'm happy. No, I'm really happy. We were driving together the first few laps, and I got a smile from ear to ear. He did not do anything wrong. Of course, it's not Dakar, but on the other hand, I did not expect this.
No, but I think that the thing you're looking for is a car where you can actually have faith when you get to Lima. You drive off that ramp and you want to go.
It's different than last year. Last year we didn't know the car. I mean, to be honest, we were first really driving. Of course, we did a short test day in LA, but we start to understand the Jefferies Buggy during the rally itself. So now we know where the positive side is and also where the difficulties are of this car. And this is what we changed on the car when we were making different setup changes, different mind, a little bit cooling, and you know, to be honest, big differences. And then once you start driving and you have at least 2 hours, no difficulties, you're like, okay, the start feels already very strong, and this is what you need. You need confidence, and that's what we have now.
Well, last year you started with a 100% Jefferies Buggy. 30% Coronel now, 35, 40?
In hours or car?
In car. In
no,
hours,
no, no.
It's 100%.
The basics is still the Jefferies, yep. The middle and the Wishbones, and for the rest now it's Coronel.
Good. So they go to Spain, they go testing, and of course Tom Kem goes with them.
Dakar 2019. The Beast, Part 2. A new design. 2018 difficulties solved. Less weight, a lot less weight. More cooling, much more cooling. And more power. The goal, strong car, strong finish.
May I present to you the Beast Part 2. Well, there it is. Tim, would you just join me for a quick moment on stage? Congratulations with this car, Tommy. And please, I mean, I know I'm going to curse myself for saying that, but it is at least the shiniest I've ever seen it.
Yep.
Wow.
It's... Eat my dust, but it's still clean now. Still some detailed things I think we need to work out, but we're very happy. You see the design is different, especially on the back. You see the air scoops on the front lights, the double shocks, which is good for the camera. You can see the double shocks on the suspension. And, which is a big change, is you don't see the spare wheels on the back. We have at the moment the spare wheels behind the doors, just for the balance of the car, for the weight distribution. So yeah, it's handling better, it feels stronger. But when you fix problems, you will always find probably other difficulties.
Yes, and we won't talk about them tonight. Of course, they have all their trusted partners. I won't mention them all, but like you can see them on the car. This will be the car that will drive off the podium in Lima. Early January 2019 for the Beast Part 2. This weekend, this Sunday, if you're in Holland, come to Valkenswaard. If you can find it, just look on the map and you can still buy tickets for the RTLGP Preplo, where Tim will be in action. You'll be gone, won't you?
Yeah, because I will be flying tomorrow to Japan because this weekend I will have my WTCR race with my Honda Civic Type R. So, sorry, I won't be there, but... you know, this is the good thing of being twins. You can share moments. So Tim will be in Valkenswaard.
Yeah, yeah, and you will regret going to Japan because we will have a lot more fun with the Beast. Thank you for watching on YouTube, on Facebook. If you like it, please press the like button. Follow those guys on whatever social media channel you can find because they're on every channel there is in the world and probably one in the universe as well. This is the Beast Part 2. The party will start here. Thank you for watching and see you soon from Lima. Bye.
Dank je wel.
Dank je wel.
Thank you. Thank you.